Y'all can be seated. Man. This thing working? Hallelujah. Set a fire. Set a fire, huh? Man, I need a fire set sometimes. I need a fire set all the time. Amen. And it's good to be here again. We had a great time Sunday. I love the Word of God. I love the people of God. I love the Spirit of God. Man, I just love God. You know, I'm going to take a few minutes and just share why I love Him so much. Some of you heard a little bit of this the other day, but for many years of my life, I was a drug addict and a criminal and an idiot, man. But on this day in 2013, God came and He changed all of that. He changed all of it. And I'm not going back. I'm not going back. I'm not going back. You know what? This has nothing to do with my message, but I want to read something out of Hebrews that caught my eye this morning. Me and a brother in Christ was sharing about it, you know, and he called me and he told me about it, and then I haven't been able to get it out of my mind. But Hebrews chapter 11 is like, they call it the Hall of Faith, and it talks about all of the great people of faith that were in the Old Testament. Talks about Abel and Enoch and Noah and Abraham and Sarah and Joseph and Jacob, and it talks about all of them, but tucked right in the middle of that. And guys, this is for you. This is for you. My heart is for you guys. I know I'm here to preach to the church as well, but I just want you guys to hear this because it's so important to us. And anyways, right in between where it's telling what all of these people says, it says this, starting at verse 13, it says, "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims in the earth." They recognized that this wasn't their home. Their eyes was on something else. Amen. And so I'm going to keep reading. Check this out. It says, verse 14, "For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had an opportunity to go back." Amen? "But now they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, and He has prepared for them a city." And what I want you guys to catch out of that is once God gets a hold of you and He delivers you from that old country, you don't have nothing to do with that old country anymore. Our sights and our focus needs to be forward on that new country, that heavenly country. And because here's the deal. Because if we put our mind on that country, there's a good chance that we'll end up back in that country. Amen? Amen. That's got nothing to do with what I want to preach tonight, but that thing was just burning in me, and I need to preach it. Amen? I need to preach it. John chapter number 4. If you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter 4, and he's got the NIV up here. I'm going to be reading out of the King James, and I'm going to be referencing the King James because there's some words in my Bible that's not going to be up on that screen that I think are really important to the message that I want to share with you tonight. Amen? When you get to there, tell me amen. Amen. If you're not there yet, say wait. Hallelujah. Man, you guys are better on Tuesday than you are on Sunday. Glory to God. Says this, it says, "So Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where He made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. And when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea and into Galilee, he went unto him, and he besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Then Jesus said unto him, Except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. The nobleman says unto him, Sir, come down, or my child is going to die. And Jesus says unto him, Go thy way, thy son lives. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, "Thy son liveth." Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend, and they said unto him, "Yesterday at the seventh hour the fever left him." So the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, "Thy son lives," and himself believed, and his whole house. What a great testimony right there, huh? What a great story. Let's pray this evening. Father, I love you and I thank you for tonight. God, I thank you for another opportunity to preach the gospel, God. But I recognize, God, that I have no ability of my own to do what only you can do through your Spirit. And so, God, I ask you to anoint me tonight. Anoint me to preach. Anoint me to speak. Anoint me to think, God. Let the words be clear and concise, God. Take away any wit or wisdom of my own, God, and replace it with the wisdom of God. I ask, God, that you would give me a divine unction, that the word would go forth tonight, not just in word only, not as some lecture or motivational speech, mighty God, but that it would go forth in the power and demonstration of the Holy Ghost of God. God, we need you tonight, and I just expect you to come and help us tonight. Help us not only to preach, God, but help us to hear. Father, let us leave out of here different than we came in. Oh, God, that we would just even have your fingerprints on our hearts when we walked out of here tonight, God. I pray all this in the name of Jesus, believing. And the church said, amen. 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 Is God not good? God is so good. You know, I'll be honest with you. I wrote this sermon when I was still, it's grown as I've gone along, but I wrote this sermon before I ever knew I was a preacher. God gave me this message when I was reading the Bible as a student in Teen Challenge, probably in some of my early months. But as I've gone on, I've learned that it's not just a message for men and women that are in programs, but it's a message for the church. How many of you know that we struggle with the same things that these guys struggle, just in a different area? Amen. And so I just want to talk to you a little bit tonight about what we want from God and what God wants. How many of you know that we come to God usually in desperation? We come to God when we've exhausted all of our own ideas and our own everything that we can do, and we run out of everything, we've exhausted everything. You guys know what I'm talking about. I don't know why it's like that. I don't know why, because now that I know God, let me tell you something. He's the first place I go when I have a problem. He's the first place I go to when I have a difficulty. But back when I was living in my sin and I was trying to get out of my sin, it wasn't until I was in a place of utter helplessness and sheer desperation that I would call on the name of Jesus to help me. But you know what's good news for you and me? Christianity is a religion for the desperate. It's only when we can get out of our own way, when we can get out of God's way, that he'll come in and he'll do what we could never do. And you know what? He can do it in a moment. God can do what we've tried to do for years and decades that we could never do. God can come in a moment of surrender like a flood and change everything around. Let me tell you something. He did it for me. We come to God and we want all of these things, right? We want what? Freedom from addiction, amen? Freedom from alcoholism. We want our husband or our wife to come to church, or we want our family restored, or we want maybe healing in our body, or maybe we have a financial difficulty that we need God to fix, and we have all of these desires from God that we come to him with, amen? And that's not a problem. He wants us to come to him. He's our Father, amen? But let me tell you what God wants. How many of you know that God just wants one thing from us? One thing. You know what that is? That we would believe. I want you to look at somebody beside you and say, God only wants us to believe. God only wants us to believe. We want all of these things, but God just wants us to believe. And you know what he does? He orchestrates circumstances to get us to a place of belief. The story that I read, that's exactly what was going on. That man came to Jesus as desperate as any one of us have ever come, with a desire, with a desperate desire. And Jesus looked at him and he said, what? Unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. And you have to read between the lines to hear the rest of it, but the rest of it would be this. Unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe, but I want you to believe. So I'm going to hook up some things, and I'm going to put some things together, and I'm going to send you home and not do it the way that you expected, so that you'll come to a place of belief that will change you forever. How many of you know that's what God's doing in these men's lives? How many of you know that's what God's doing in all of our lives if we'll just look around? Amen. God wants us to believe. And I, the more I study and read the Gospel of John and the rest of the Bible, it's as if it was written. I know the Gospel of John especially seems like it was written with that idea in mind, that the one reading it would believe. I say that because you can look in the Gospel of John and you can count the word believe and you'll find it over 100 times in some form. It was so important that it was put in there over and over. John 3:16 says, what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. John 7:34 is another one of my favorites because I get to experience it for myself and witness it. John 7:34 says this, it's a promise. It says, for him who believeth, as the scripture says, I like that they put that part in the King James because it's not to him who believeth as we believe, as we think, but as the scripture says, you know what happens? It says, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. How many of you know that's what's happening up here tonight? Because I couldn't do this on my own. I'm too embarrassed. I'm shy. I can't get up and talk in front of a crowd. But I know that if I believe in Jesus, he wants to flow rivers of living water out of my belly so that maybe some of it will get on somebody else and they would come to that place of belief. Hallelujah. Praise God. John 19:35 says this, John saw and bare record of these things. In other words, he saw what was going on and he wrote them down for you and me that we might believe. This is one of my favorites that tells exactly what I'm trying to tell you right here. John 20 and 31 says this, these things I have written unto you that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and in believing you would have life in his name. He goes so far as to make it plain for us. I wrote this stuff down so that when you read it, you can believe that Jesus is who he says he is, and in believing that you might have life in his name. How many of you know that's the only way to eternal life? That's the only way to the Father, is believing in the Son. And believing, I'm getting ready to mess y'all up. I'm getting ready to mess y'all up. This is the part that's going to ruin you. How many of you know that we're only responsible for what we know? You guys understand that? But when you know something, you're responsible for that now. Amen? So if you don't want more responsibility in your Christianity, you might duck out the side door right now because I'm getting ready to lay something on you that's going to bring great responsibility to your Christian walk. How many of you is ready? The original language that this book was written in was Greek and Aramaic. Most of it was Greek. The Greek word, believe, isn't what we think it is. Webster's dictionary defines belief as this, to consider something to be true or to accept the word of it. You guys get that? So if this guy is a trustworthy guy, and everything that he's told me in the past is right, and he comes and tells me something, I can buy into that idea. That's what we think believe is. Amen? Is that not what we think it means? I'm getting ready to mess you up, though, because this was written in Greek. The word for believe in the Greek is a word called pistio, and it means this. Listen to me carefully. It means to rely upon. It means, this one's going to mess you boys up. It means to commit to the charge of. That means you're no longer the shot caller. You no longer have control over your life and your life's decisions. When you commit to the charge of the Lord Jesus Christ, that means he is your Lord. He's not just your friend. He's not just your healer. He's not just your Savior. He's the one that's in charge of your life, and he will never direct you to put a needle in your arm again. That's one of the good things. He'll never direct you to run around on your wife or your husband. If you commit to the charge of the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll not only have your heavenly home secured, but you'll have a life of ease and a life not of ease, not necessarily ease, but you'll have a life that is more abundant than you had before here on earth. How many of you know that the Son came that we would have life and have it more abundantly? Abundant life doesn't mean an abundance of things. Sometimes you may get an abundance of things. Sometimes you may not. But if you have Jesus, let me tell you something. God never gave me another thing. I'd have everything just to have Him. So many people want what Jesus can give them, but they don't want Him. Man, if you ever see Him the way that I've seen Him, you won't ever want nothing else. You'll never want nothing else. He's the most desirable thing that I've ever encountered. So do you understand the difference? Got quiet in here, didn't it? Here, let me break it down for you. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would commit to the charge of Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It's a little bit different, isn't it? It's easy to buy into an idea. It's not so easy to walk the way Jesus would have you to walk. Obedience is much more important than it's preached today. It's what I love about programs, man. They teach us discipline. They teach us obedience. You know, what these guys will get in a year, man, Christians spend a lifetime trying to get. It's awesome. It's awesome. We can look through the Bible and we can find that different people have different requirements to coming to that place of belief. Let me give you some examples. The Bible says that Jesus' disciples at the first miracle was when Jesus turned water into wine. Amen. But you know what? They were already His disciples. They were already walking with Him. They were already following Him. But you know what it says? After He turned the water into wine and they witnessed it and they saw it, the Bible says then His disciples believed. There was folks in the Bible that the Bible says that their blinded eyes were open and it caused them to believe. There was others who were lame and had never walked and they got up and Jesus healed them and it caused them to walk. And the Bible says because of that they believed. There's a place where loaves and fish were spread out and fed a whole bunch of people. And it says those that were there believed. There was one cat named Nathaniel. Bible says he believed simply because Jesus said that He saw him under a tree. Here's the problem with many of us, though. God gets us to that place of belief. He does something miraculous that we've cried about, that we've prayed about, and God moves in our situation and changes the situation, and we throw up our hands and we say, "Oh, I believe, I believe." And then a week later, things aren't going our way, and we say something like, "God, I'll believe if you." When we get to that place of belief, we need to settle there and recognize that Jesus not only caused us to be saved and born again, but He is also desiring to be the shot caller of our lives. And let me tell you something, there ain't nothing wrong with that. Pride says, "I can do it," but you know what? God is taking more and more of this old boy's pride away, and I'm so thankful. I'm so grateful that I can get under good leadership and I can ask them questions about decisions that I have, that I don't have to decide myself anymore. You know that? You don't know how much relief that is to not have to go through life trying to figure things out because I have a guide. I have a guide inside, and I have guides with many men and women in Christ that have been going at this a little bit longer than me. Amen. The bottom line is this. God desires us to believe. Y'all got it? Can I move on? Can I preach now? I just wanted to set the stage. Amen. Let's look at our text. Verses 46 and 47, we see Jesus is returning from Jerusalem and he stops at Cana. And Cana from Capernaum, where this nobleman was from, is about 20 or 25 miles from each other. Amen? So it's a long distance. We see a desperate dad with a sick son. Let's just read it real quick. It says, so Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee where he made the water wine. It says there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. And when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and he besought him that he would come down and heal his son because his son was dying. How many of you in here have children? If your kid was sick unto death, if your kid was on his deathbed, what would you do to rectify the situation? Yeah, that's a good one. The only thing that I can come up with, I have one son, the only thing that I can think of is the word anything. I would do anything that my son would live and not die. Would you agree with me? I would do whatever it takes. And remember, I've told you guys how I read the Bible. I read between the lines. So you guys are just going to have to use your imagination and go with me to Capernaum for a few minutes. Are you willing to do that tonight? I think about this man. The Bible says that he was a nobleman. How many of you know what that is? I'm not absolutely sure, but it would seem to me it's a man of nobility, huh? A man of means, maybe a mayor or a city councilman or somebody who had the world at his disposal, probably had some money in the bank. He could probably do whatever he needed to do, amen? When his son got sick, he probably could call doctors and specialists in, amen? Would you buy that? And so I picture the scene. The Bible says when he heard that Jesus was come, how did he hear? We got to use our imagination again. I picture this man at the deathbed of his son. Maybe his son came home one day and he stopped eating. Maybe he had a fever. He was throwing up and it just continued to get worse until finally he's laying there unconscious one day and his dad's got a wet rag and he's just praying over him and he's just considering what to do next. And he hears a knock on the door. He goes to the door. And there's another nobleman standing there, somebody, one of his peers. And he says, how's Johnny doing today? He says, man, it don't look good. Have you tried, Dr. Sahel, I've tried him. Have you tried, man, I've tried everything. It doesn't seem like anything is working. I don't know what to do. I'm at my wit's end. If something doesn't change soon, I just know he's going to pass. And I just think that man had heard something. I can't help but think, you know, they didn't have cell phones. They didn't have CNN and Fox News. They didn't have all that stuff. But let me tell you something. If there's a dude going through the countryside, opening blinded eyes and causing lame people to walk and healing folks and casting out demons, I guarantee you that people were talking and it had gotten to Capernaum by now. And I can't help but think that man was out by the gate hearing something about this Jesus. And he thought, man, I need to go tell my friend about this. And I can't help but think that he said to that desperate dad, have you heard about Jesus? No. Oh man, what I've just heard is that he's causing people that have never seen before to see. He's causing people that couldn't walk to get up and run and dance in the temple. He's causing this and he's casting out devils and maybe if you can get Johnny to him, maybe if you can just get Johnny to where Jesus is. And I hear that he's at Cana. You know what? Last time he was there, he turned a whole bunch of barrels of water into wine. Maybe if you can get Johnny to Jesus. Go to the next verse, brother. No, go back. See, that's why I need King James. That's why I know. This man heard that Jesus had arrived in Galilee from Judea. He went unto him and he begged him to come down and heal his son. Maybe that's okay. Let me show you what King James says. It says, when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and he besought. that he would come down and heal his son. Now, that's one of the reasons I read King James. Because you know why? Because I don't know what that word means. So you know what it does? It makes me dig a little bit deeper. Let me tell you, man, you need to dig in the word. There's stuff in there that's buried that unless you're hungry and desperate for something from God, you'll never find it. And I began to look up the word besought. And it means this. It means to beg eagerly. Not just beg, but to beg eagerly. Or to implore urgently. You know, at first glance, when you read that, you think that Jesus is coming through Cana with his troop of people, and all of a sudden this desperate dad shows up, and he says, hey man, my son's dying. Could you come and help him? Right? Right? But once you learn what besought means, it changes the whole dynamic of it. It's not that at all anymore. Now you've got a man of nobility, probably dressed in a three-piece suit that throws caution to the wind. It doesn't matter who's looking. It doesn't matter who's around. He gets to the side of Jesus and he falls down and he says, you've got to come and save my son. My son is going to die if somebody doesn't do something. Begging, pleading. He's never seen Jesus before in his life. All he has is the words of someone else. How many of you know sometimes that's all we have? Some of you, maybe that's all you have tonight. I can tell you with everything in me, look me in my eyes. Jesus is the real thing, brother. Jesus has the solution for every problem that we have ever had. Jesus is the answer for every desperate dad, every desperate mom, every desperate wife, every desperate husband. He's the answer for everything. Begged him. My son is dying. You've got to come. Go to the next one. I love that. Unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. Seems out of place in that conversation, doesn't it? I don't know about you, but it seemed out of place to me. You know, when I first read it, when I was young in my faith, I thought, you know, Jesus was rebuking the man. Doesn't it seem like that? Let me tell you, he's not rebuking him at all. You know what he's doing? He's giving him a statement of fact. He's telling him, basically, you know what? I can heal your son, but if I just do it and you go on, you'll never believe. But I want you to believe, so I'm going to orchestrate circumstances. I mean, I just think about that conversation coming from the life that I've come out of. I don't know, how would you react to that? Let me break it down for you. I'm down on my knees begging for my dying son. You got to come and heal him. And Jesus, how many of you know Jesus is the coolest cat, dude, that ever lived? Jesus never responds the way we would respond, does he? How many of you know a lot of times Jesus don't respond at all? When people talk crazy to him, sometimes he don't even say nothing. He's right in the dirt. I know we laugh, but wouldn't it be cool to have that? What do you do when somebody talks crazy to you? You turn around, you talk crazy back to him. That's what I do. Give me what Jesus has. I just think about this desperate father at his wit's end. He just walked 25 miles to beg this man, and this man puts his hand on his shoulder, and he looks down at him, and he tells him a riddle. Unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. Dude, back into life, huh? I'd have got up. I'd have grabbed him by the scruff of his collar. And I would have said, man, evidently you're not listening. Evidently you don't hear me. My son is dying, and unless somebody does something... Go to the next one. It's exactly what happens. Sir, come down or my child's going to die. You didn't hear me, so let me say it a little bit louder. Next one. Jesus replied, your son will live. Let me read it in King James, because see, it doesn't give you all of it. Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy son lives. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. I know that's what it says there, but as we go on a little bit further, you're going to see that sometimes all we have is just a little bit of belief. Sometimes all we have is just enough to head in the direction that Jesus wants us to go. But let me tell you something. If that's all you have, take a step and take another step and just take what little bit of faith you have and go. Here's where this is relatable to us, guys. The man came to Jesus desperate. He wanted help for his problem, help for his dilemma. And then when he got to Jesus, he wanted Jesus to do it the way that he thought it should go down. Amen. You got to come with me and heal my son, because that's what my homeboy said you did to everybody else. You always laid your hand on him, or you always touched him, or you spoke a word over him. My son is 25 miles away. If you don't come, he's going to die. And Jesus looks at this man that he'd never met before. The man had never had dealings with Jesus before. And he tells him, go on home. He's going to be all right. It's easy to clap. It ain't your son. I can't imagine what was going through that dude's mind. Wait a minute. That ain't how it was supposed to go down. He said, if I can get my son to Jesus, or get my Jesus to my son. But now, I don't have nothing but his word. Whew. I don't know if y'all felt the Holy Ghost on that, but let me break that down to you. The word of Jesus is Jesus. His word, look here, how many words is that in red in my Bible? It's go thy way, thy son liveth. Six words. All he had out of the mouth of the Lord Jesus Christ was six words. But let me tell you something, if that's all he gives you, that's all you need, that you can go on and you can receive your healing. You can trust that he is faithful to complete whatever he starts. That's how my Jesus is. But so many times we come to God and we want him to do it the way we've seen it done before. Amen. I'm going to meddle with you guys a little bit. Is that all right? I know I worked at Teen Challenge, and I can remember going into Teen Challenge broken, fully surrendered, or so I thought, willing to do anything, or so I thought, weeping and crying, help me, can you help me? I'll do anything. Sitting in that intake office, anybody, can I get a witness? Anybody so broken that you were willing to do whatever they wanted you to do? And so they gave you a bed, gave you some food. About 2 weeks in, dude, you guys are a cult. I ain't doing that. What's that got to do with anything? How's that going to help me get free from addiction? How? Anybody, can I get a witness? Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? Dude, I went into Teen Challenge, and we had about 28 guys. We had what they call dorm leaders. These were student leaders. They were on my level, but they had been there long enough that they could tell me stuff. Five of them. The oldest one was 21 or 22. I was 46 years old. The rest of them were like 17 and 18. You give a guy that age the ability to tell people stuff, they just gonna tell people stuff. I do that a lot. God, what is this? God be looking down saying, how bad you want it, son? He say, you asked me for help. This is what the help looks like. Yeah, but God, that's ridiculous. I used to go to a thrift store 5 or 6 days a week, 8 hours a day, and hang up women's clothes. I don't know, y'all ever hung up women's clothes? Some of that stuff Got 5 and 6 holes. I don't even know how you put it on, much less put it on a hanger. And I can remember standing over that table with another old man, and we would just be grumbling like, what does this have to do with anything? How is this going to help me? And God said, how bad you want it? And he reminded me of something terrible in my addiction. You know, the devil will remind us of stuff too. The devil likes to remind us of the motel room tables full of crack. Huh? Or the pockets full of money. The things that only happened maybe once. And maybe it didn't even happen to you. One of your homeboys that happened to it, so you just took that on. Amen? That's one of the memories that the devil would give you. Huh? He would never remind you of watching your grandma cry because you stole a ring out of her jewelry box that had been in the family for ages. And you can't get it back. The devil won't remind you of that because that won't draw you back in. I tell you, man, ask God when you're having a bad day, when you're wanting to jet, say, God, remind me of something that'll keep me here. Remind me of something so I don't go back, because I don't want to go back. Anybody want to go back? None of us want to go back. But sometimes things that we don't agree with in God's plan to help us will cause us to throw up our hands and go back. Amen? You guys know what I'm talking about. How many of you had your stuff packed before? Anybody? Us older cats, man, I packed my stuff a bunch of times. Bless God, he kept me though. He kept me. God's ways are different than our ways. You know, Jesus could have said, come on, let's go. As a matter of fact, one of you boys bring a chariot so we can get on over there quick and I can heal this guy's son and get back over here to Cana and get back on my plan. But instead, Jesus had a setup. You know what? Jesus has a setup for you. This program that you're in, it's your 25 miles walk of faith. That's what I like to call this message, a 25 mile walk of faith. Because that man had to walk all the way home with no outward assurance that his son was healed. He didn't have a phone he could call. He didn't have nothing like that. All he had was the words of Jesus. Man, I have learned that there's nothing better to have than the words of Jesus in my pocket, in my heart. Oh, thank you, Jesus. God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. Turn with me to 2 Kings chapter number 5. I want to share something that's right along the lines of what I'm telling you. Something that I think you'll be able to relate to this a little bit better. 2 Kings chapter number 5. And 2 Kings chapter 5 is the chapter, or at least half of it, is about a man named Naaman. Now, Naaman was he was a warrior dude. He was a captain in the Syrian army. He had won many battles. He had a whole lot of accolades. He probably had a bunch of medals. He probably had done great things. The king loved him. He was a great man of valor. That first verse is kind of like a little bio. It says, now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram, or Syria. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded because through him the Lord had given victory. He was a mighty man of valor, and then there's a comma, and I want you to notice the three-letter word, but. That was me. I had done many great things in my life. I was a great welder. I was good at this, and I was good at that, but most of my life, I was just a junkie. People would call me to do work for them, but they would only do it if they could station somebody outside to watch me, because I'd take their stuff. I was good at certain things, but just like Naaman had leprosy. You know what leprosy is? You know, how many of you know that the Old Testament is full of types and shadows of the New Testament and even our own lives? Leprosy. You know what leprosy represented? Sin. Leprosy represented addiction. Leprosy represented prostitution, sin, alcoholism. You put whatever label you want on it, it's the same thing. You know why I say leprosy was that? Because leprosy was the thing that kept Naaman isolated. If you had leprosy in those days, you couldn't even go around your family. Your family didn't want to be around you. It was a dirty disease. Sound familiar? Sound familiar? When we get so deeply entrenched in sin, whether it's alcoholism, prostitution, whether it's drug addiction, whatever it is, how many of our people want to be around us? How many times do we really want to be around our people? It isolates us. It keeps us separated. It keeps us miserable. And I'm just going to tell you the story. I'm not going to read it all. But anyway, so Naaman had this dreaded disease. And even though he was a mighty man of valor and had won many wars, he was isolated from his own wife and his own children and his own people. But the Bible goes on to say that Naaman's wife had a little slave girl, a little servant girl. And she was from Israel. She was one of God's people. And the truth of the matter is, Naaman had actually captured her on one of his raids. How many of you know that God will use the craziest things to get our attention and to teach us and to heal us? And this little maiden girl, she told Naaman's wife one day, they were probably doing braiding hair or something, whatever they do. She said, if you can get your husband to where I'm from, he can be healed. Well, the king of Syria heard this. And so the king of Syria loved this commander, this army captain so much that he put together a bunch of loot, some jewelry and some fine clothing. And he wrote a letter to the king of Israel. And he gave the letter to Naaman himself. And he said, take this to the king of Israel. And the Bible says that Naaman got his chariots and some of his boys, and they rode on over to the king of Israel. He handed him the letter. The king of Israel read the letter, and the Bible says that he tore his clothes. And the reason he tore his clothes is this. Let me look at verse 7. It says, and it came to pass when the king of Israel had read the letter that he tore his clothes, and he says, am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man does sent me to recover a man of his leprosy? Wherefore, consider, I pray you, how you seek a quarrel against me. You guys get that? What the king of Israel was saying was, dude, you just beat us up a month or two ago, and now you're back here picking a fight because I have no ability within myself to heal anybody of anything. So you must be trying to stir up trouble. So he told some people to send Naaman away. And verse 8 says, and it was so when Elisha, the man of God, had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king saying, wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. I don't know if you understand what that meant, but to know that there's a prophet in a place means to know that there is a God in a place. Because where there's a prophet, there's a man of God, and where there's a man of God, he has the power of God. He said, send him to me. So now God is using a little teenage girl from the enemy. Now he's using a prophet. Watch this, guys. It gets better. It gets better. God taught me so much through this. And Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot, and he stood at the door of Elisha. It's probably a tent door. You probably can't knock. It probably sounded like this. Stood at the door of Elisha's house. Let's see what the next one says. And Elisha sent a messenger to him and said, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored and you will be cleansed. What a powerful statement. What would you do? I'd be running down to the river, wouldn't you? But I want you to catch what it says, because if you ain't really paying attention, you'll miss it. Elisha sent for Naaman, right? Elisha said, send him to me, the great prophet, right? He comes to the door of Elisha, and what happens? And Elisha sent a 17-year-old intern to answer the door, a dorm leader. And you got to bear with, you got to just use your imagination. Now, if Naaman was a captain of the Syrian army, he was probably a big dude. If he was a captain, he was probably, I like to think he was in his 50s, probably had battle scars, had leprosy all over him and stuff. He was probably a rough-looking cat, amen? Big muscles like Norm, you know what I'm talking about? This little 17-year-old dude opened the door, and there's Naaman standing there. And he looks up at him and he said, I know this is going to sound crazy, but the dude, yeah, he's busy. He's writing a book or something. But he sent me to tell you, if you just go wash in the river. Yeah, no, not like that. You got to dip 7 times. Yeah, you can't just go and get in it and look cool. You got to go dip 7 times in the Jordan and you're going to be good, man. You're going to be all right. It's kind of different, ain't it? Kind of different when you're expecting the man of God. So many times we're expecting something from God that God wants to do it in a different way because he'll be glorified so much more if he uses a little Israeli servant girl and then he uses another little servant from the same camp. You know, Naaman didn't just have leprosy. He had pride. He was full of pride. He went there to see the man of God, didn't he? I'm going to read this one out of the King James. And man, it's so much better. Verse 11 says, but Naaman was wroth. And he went away and said, behold, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place and recover me of my leprosy. See, it says angry there. King James says wroth. How many of you know what wroth is? You really shouldn't say wroth during COVID because here's what I think wroth is. I think wroth is spitting mad because you can't even say wroth without spitting a little bit. Amen. You got to get over here and look at the wall. Wroth. He was wroth and he went away wroth. He was spitting mad. He was so fired up. He had the solution. He had the answer to his dilemma, but he was so mad by the way it came down the pipe that he was willing to go back home to Syria in his same sick condition that he showed up in. How many of us do that? We laugh, but how many times do we come to God for help? He gives us some help. We don't like the help, so we leave in the same condition that we came in because we're unsatisfied with the way God wants to do it. Am I preaching to somebody tonight? I love what he says because it reminds me of TV preachers. He says, I thought surely he would come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and put his hand on my head and say, heal, $50 bill like they do on TV. But since he didn't do it that way, I'm just going to go back to where I came from in my same sick condition with the same swollen leprosy all over me, with the same addicted disease that I came here with because I don't like the way it came down. Amen. Praise God. Now, there's 2 servants right there that God was trying to use to get his attention. He didn't use the professionals. That's what I love about addiction ministries like Teen Challenge and this. You know what the staff is really for, guys? Just to tell you when to get up, make sure you got food. You know who really healed? You know how you really get healed there? Through each other. You guys heal each other. God uses broken things to heal broken things. And you know what? You know why it's so powerful? Because if you'll do it the right way and you'll let God use one another to mold you and shape you, as the scripture says, iron sharpens iron. You know what will happen 5 years from now when you have a child or a grandbaby? You know who you're going to call? You're not going to call the homeboys from the street. You're going to call them dudes that seen you at your worst, that seen you at your lowest. When you have a bad situation or a bad day or somebody in your family passes away and you need somebody to pray, you know who you're going to call? You're going to call the dudes that you prayed with, the dudes that you circled up every Tuesday night and called on the Lord with. You might be mad at each other once in a while, but let me tell you something, you guys are growing a bond that most people won't ever experience. Accountability. Somebody that'll see you in Walmart and say, Reuben, you're looking funny today. What's going on? I don't need people in my life that's going to let me make it. How many of you used to say, oh man, just let me make it. Just let me make it. Dude, people used to let me make it all the way into the penitentiary. I don't want somebody to let me make it today. I want somebody to call me on my stuff. I'm so off my message. That's for somebody. Y'all write that down, whoever that's for. Amen. You know when you know what I'm talking about, Rudy, when you ask the Holy Ghost to help you preach, when he wants to jump in and help, you got to yield to him. Amen. Amen. So check this out. It gets better. Verse 12, he goes on to say, it's not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Why can't I go home? Those rivers that he was just talking about were in Syria, and they were crystal clear. They were clean. Let me tell you about the River Jordan. The River Jordan was in the enemy's land. The River Jordan was filthy. It was dirty. It's where the enemy washed their clothes. He had to look silly in front of his enemies. I can imagine my pride would probably stop me from doing that. And like I said, the man of God didn't say just go down there and get in the water like you're cooling off and get out. He said go down there and dip seven times in front of your enemies while they're over there washing their chonies. I mean, I don't know. There was something that caused him to not want to do what God wanted him to do, to receive his healing. There's something in us that causes pride to rise up and say, I ain't doing that. You know what the best thing I learned to get deep within me in my Christian walk? Two words. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Especially if I'm not the shot caller anymore. You know why? It gives you freedom. We think when we come in submission that we're not free, but that's the freest place you can be. Because if you're doing what somebody else tells you to do and it don't work out right, I'm off the hook. Rudy told me, Pastor. Rudy, tell him you told me. Verse 13, this is probably one of the most powerful verses of this. It says, then his servants came near and spake to him. It says now he had already used the prophet's servant and his wife's servant, but now his own servant came. Sometimes the voice of reason comes from the most ridiculous place. And when I think of Naaman's servant being this great big warrior dude, Naaman's servant was probably a teenage boy that would run and go get the arrows that missed the mark. Amen? Probably the guy that went and got water and food. He was probably the guy that shined the shields. Probably didn't have a whole lot of fighting responsibility. He was just the servant to this great warrior guy. And he comes to Naaman. He comes to this great warrior dude, and he looks up at him. And I can just imagine, because he can see it. How many of you know that people all around you can see what you can't see because your pride has you blinded? And he comes over to him, and he says, My father, if the man of God had asked you to do some great thing, wouldn't you do it? Dude, why not go and go in the water seven times? Dude, we're already here. What have you got to lose? He didn't say, how long is y'all's program? 1 year? How many times have people come in and say things like, I'm just going to do about 3 months? Get my weight back. Get my wife back talking to me. Yeah, I know it's a 1-year program, but I just need that. Servant said, man, why not? Dude, you're already here. You know what I tell guys in programs so many times when they say, dude, you don't understand, it's hard. I know it's hard. It's easier to be in the penitentiary behind the fence. It's easier. You know why? Because you ain't got no choice. You got a choice over there every day, don't you? Whether you stay or go, every day, it's a fight. It's a battle from within, especially when you have a bad day. But you're already there. You want to know the truth? As hard as it is to be there, the hard part's done. I don't know about you, but the hard part for me was getting there. The hard part for me was putting the bag down, putting the spoon down, putting the pipe down. The hard part for me was going through the withdrawals and getting detox so I could go there. The hard part for me was finally making a decision and sticking by the decision because I talked about it for a long time. But once you're there, it's just like the servant. Dude, you're already in Israel. Why would you go all the way back to Syria without at least trying it? So Naaman wised up. The last verse that I have is verse 14, and it says, so he went down. Woo! It says, so he went down and he dipped himself. What did it say? Did he dip himself three times? Did he just put his foot in and get back out? Did he dip himself four times or five times or even six times? Did he go in a one-year program and stay 2 months, 3 months, 7 months? Dipped in the Jordan seven times as what? As the man of God had told him. Whew, and this is the best part. This thing here is going to have me running. And his flesh was restored. And his flesh was restored as the flesh of a little child. I don't know if you're getting that or not. I don't know if you understand the magnitude of that. But not only did the man have leprosy, he had battle scars. He had probably been sunburned and had wrinkles. And he had been worn out from life's choices. But when he did what God said to do, he got a do-over. How many of you need a do-over? How many of you would like a do-over in life? Amen. How many of you would like to start completely over? How many of you know that that's what being born again means? Being born again. I'm only 7 years old. That's why I can run around like this. I'm a kid. If y'all had monkey bars in here, I probably wouldn't even be preaching. I'd be on the monkey bars. Hallelujah. He got a do-over. Let's go back to John. I'm almost through. Y'all ready for me to be done? I am. I'm going to start working out now. I've seen what I've done for Pastor Norman. That sun gun. I ain't gonna cross him. First thing he does, man, when you jack with him, you know what he does? He looks at you and he swells up and he says, this ain't no game, bro. I mean, I've been staying in that apartment behind his house, man. I don't know how many times he walks by and he mean mugs and says, this ain't no game, bro. I want none, man. I don't want none. Next time, bro. I'm going to work out too. Look out. It says, Jesus said to him, go that way, thy son lived. It says the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken, and he went his way. And one of my favorite verses right here is 51. And it's because it's the way of God. It's the way of God. You can look at Luke 15. You can look at all the places where people, God called people to do something, and while they were doing it, they didn't even have to get to the place that God told them to go. It says, and while he was yet coming. I want you guys to get a hold of that, because God sees your heart. He sees your intentions. And how many of you know if he sees a man's heart and intentions to do what he wants him to do, he will come and celebrate that early. He will back a broken relationship before you even have time to get out and try to fix it yourself. God loves you so much, he wants to do some of the work for you. It says, while he was still on his way, his servants met him with the news. I do like that. With the news that his boy was living. And I like to put myself there, and I can't help but think that while he was coming, and he probably was determined and purposeful. He was probably walking pretty fast because all he had was the word of Jesus, right? He probably ran some of the way. But while he was coming, man, they popped out from behind a tree and said, I don't know what happened, but yesterday Johnny got up and he started riding his bike. He was down 1 minute, and the next minute he's out running around. You would think that he would have jumped up and celebrated, wouldn't you? Because the Bible says he believed, right? Put the next verse up there. No, not that one. 52. John. Here, I can just read it, man. Messing up my jelly. It says this. It says, and as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, thy son lived. And instead of getting excited, instead of jumping up and down, you know what he did? Instead of being happy that his son was living, you know what he did? He says, What time did it happen? He had faith. He had just enough faith to walk to where those people were. But you know what? God met him with that little bit of faith and gave him the good news. And even though he asked what time the boy got better, you know what the man said? He said, yesterday at the seventh hour is what King James says. Yesterday in the afternoon, the fever left him. King James is a little bit more concise. It says, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. And he knew in that moment that Jesus was the Messiah. He knew that he was who he said he was. And the Bible says that he believed. And not only that, the next verse says that he believed and his household. Some of you have households that are waiting for you. Some of you have households that are waiting to see your faith so that they can believe. They want to believe. People want to believe in Jesus. But if they don't see it in us, who wants to buy into a powerless religion? Who wants to buy into something that you can say but you can't do? I'll just keep living the way I'm living. Jesus said to that man, he said, unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. The man wanted what he wanted, and Jesus just wanted him to believe. Let me tell you something. Following Jesus ain't always easy. Matter of fact, a lot of times it's hard. Sometimes it's really uncomfortable. But I've come to know that it's one of the most rewarding things that I've ever given myself to. Here's the truth, man. Our faith has to have some kind of basis. It has to have some turning point. Today I celebrate one. Today I know without a doubt, 7 years ago today, God came in. Nobody was there. Nobody bore witness to it but me. But you will never tell me that it wasn't what I say it was. It's the same with the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. Jesus showed up and knocked him off of his mule, blinded him, caused him to have sight again, and then put him on a mission. And you know what Paul did before he preached most times? He would tell him about what happened to him that day. He would testify. We have to have something, but let me tell you something. Our experience can only take us so far. God will give us an experience, but he wants us to walk by faith. We can't just live from experience to experience because we'll be exhausted and we'll never make it. Paul's experience produced an assurance that he used as an anchor. Jesus is not the Savior because you experience salvation. Let me tell you something. You experience salvation because he's the Savior. But his touch on your life, has God touched any of you in here? How many of you are at that place where I'm at, where you're at that unshakable faith, unshakable place of belief? You know how to get there? If you're not there yet, you can't get there on his. You can watch and you can know that God is God in him, but you got to know for yourself. The only way to know is in one of the Psalms. What does it say? Taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good. What a puzzling verse of Scripture. How you taste and see? That's like smelling and hearing. Right? No, it's not. You have to taste God for yourself. You have to digest it if you want to see the results of it. You can't just come and listen about it. You can't just hear about it. You've got to take it in. God told Ezekiel to take it all the way down to your bowels, down to the depths of yourself. You've got to taste and see for yourself. Sometimes it takes a long walk. Sometimes it takes a 25-mile walk to find out that God is who he says he is. Sometimes it takes a few minutes. Sometimes it takes 9 days of withdrawals, followed by a year of a program, followed by some more stuff. The question is, what are you willing to do to know that God is God? Because it's his desire that you believe on him. Amen. Would you bow your heads? Father, I just thank you for your word tonight, God. And I pray, God, that the soil was tilled in these hearts tonight, God. Everybody that heard the word, Father, that it would go down and settle somewhere fertile, mighty Jesus, that it would produce fruit, God, not just in their lives, but in the lives of those that come around them, God. Father, calls us to be a witness of you this week, God. Not just a witness of what you've done in our lives, God, but calls us to be a living witness of the walking, talking, breathing Jesus. God, your word says that signs would follow those that believed. God, I believe, I believe, I believe. God, let signs follow us this week, God. I'm not talking about just healing signs and miracle signs, God, but the signs that others would see our faith and come to a place of belief. God, that we would shake Hopeville, that we would shake El Centro and Brawley, God. God, give us that, God. Give us just enough faith to get to the next place. God, we praise you and we just thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you all. Thank you all.